How do you choose your cases? At what level are you analyzing this phenomenon? And what sort of evidence do we have that these sources are reliable? How many interviews did you conduct? How many individuals did you speak to? What is the typical duration of the interviews, and what's the minimum and maximum? Is there any way that you can show the readers how your process works from the data that you have to the insights that you derive? If you're able to do that, you're going to present a decent recipe for other people. The method section is usually described as the recipe for your process. Other people should go through your method section and be able to understand your process, but also be able to replicate your work if they will be interested in doing that. And while the method section tends to be straightforward in terms of structure, it packs in a lot of detail and you have very limited space within which to address the different things. In this video, I'm going to present the contents of the method section of a qualitative case study paper and the sort of key considerations or key data that is involved in your method section in order to enhance transparency for readers. So, what goes in your method section? You're going to have about 4 or 5 subsections, depending on the level of detail that you want to present. The first thing that you have to cover in your method section is the research design. So even though, yes, it's a qualitative case study paper, you have to explicitly tell your readers this is a qualitative case study approach, and you have to provide the justification for choosing this approach. So usually looking at complex phenomena that are best understood within their real-world setting. After this, you have to spend some time on describing the research setting. So because context is everything in qualitative case studies, your readers have to understand, therefore, the key features of this setting that you are exploring. So what are the key aspects or defining features of this particular context? What makes it particularly interesting for the type of problem or phenomenon that you would like to grapple with? And does it actually fit the types of questions that you would like to explore? Third, you need information on case selection. So how do you choose your cases? And in order to be able to do that, you have to specify the unit of analysis. At what level are you analyzing this phenomenon that you are studying? And so this is going to determine how many cases you are going to have. For the case selection, you have to also present your selection logic. So what is the theoretical reasons underpinning the selection of your cases, and are you choosing them because you expect them to be similar in certain ways, or are you choosing them because you expect them to be different in certain ways, or maybe a combination of the two? So you have to specify the sampling logic that helps others to understand how you selected your cases and be able to determine if the theoretical sampling is sufficient for the goal that you have regarding the study. You also have to spend some time on disclosing your data collection process and also what type of data you ultimately get. So within data collection for qualitative case studies, we're normally interested in what's your main source of data. Did you conduct interviews or are you relying on secondary data sources? And what sort of evidence do we have that these sources are reliable? So for example, in interview data, we will usually want to show that these are experts on the subject that we would like to learn more about, or maybe these are direct users of a product and we would like to know a bit more about their experience. But you have to show that whoever has been chosen or whatever source of data you are using, it's going to be relevant and it's also going to be trustworthy so that we can afterwards trust whatever claims are coming out of it. Ideally, also, your data should be varied enough, so you should have more than one data source. So, for example, interviews plus the secondary data as a way of trying to triangulate the evidence from the different sources and trying to minimize bias that might come from one of the sources. And then also, it helps to give some key figures related to the data collection. So for example, how many interviews did you conduct? How many individuals did you speak to? What is the typical duration of the interviews? And what's the minimum and maximum? If you did transcribe those interviews, how many pages of text or how many words does this translate to? Because all these are indicators of how rich the data might be or how much we can have confidence that they will lead to meaningful in-depth insights that are associated with qualitative case study research. Finally, you need to spend some time on describing your data analysis process. So what sort of analytical methods have you used? And is there any way that you can show the readers how your process works from the data that you have to the insights that you derive? So one of the most useful tools, for example, in this section is what we call a coding tree or a data structure, because it shows how you move from raw data in the form of quotes or statements made by respondents to higher level constructs that might be the ones that you're interested in studying and understanding the key relationships related to that. It also helps to present any tools that you may have used as part of the analysis process. So there's some tools that we use for qualitative research like atlas.ti or Envivo, or even things like Excel. I personally use Excel a lot, but it can help sometimes for your readers to understand the tools that you have used, especially if they will be interested to replicate what you have done. So the next time that you have to write the method section of a qualitative research paper, just remember the five main bits of information that you need. First of all, what is the research design that you have adopted? What is the research setting within which you conduct this research? What is the case selection? How did you select your cases and what's the rationale for that selection? How did you collect your data? And what types of data have you collected and for what reasons? And then finally, what is your analysis process? If you're able to do that and be able to condense it, you're going to have a really good structure and you're going to present a decent recipe for other people who might be interested in replicating your work or achieving some kind of clarity in terms of your overall process, so it makes it auditable for other people. I'm Dr. Nonichi Extra. Happy writing.